DPCDs, we don't need PCP. We don't need flat screen TVs and DVDs. We need more knowledge of who we be. See, really know where the guns come from? Do we really know where the drugs come from? How come it only affects us and not them? How come Jesus Christ has still not come? Why am I wrong if I kill a nigga to punch me? But it's right for you to blow up a whole country. Shit, shock TV, understand it. We here now.
Peace. Welcome to a special edition of Wayne's World / Up and Up TV. I'm here with Atlantic recording artist, Brooklyn MC, Saigon. Let's get it back to the start of your rhyming, man. We got you into this. Who are your influences on that good stuff?
I always rap to myself. You know what I mean? I never let nobody know I could rap. But I used to always write my little rap since I was like 9 or 10 years old.
And who was the first person that told you that? That's all right, man.
Like you know, the first person told me it was all right was my sister. Not my two sisters is here, but I got another sister named LaDedra who I used to run to and be like, how that sound? She's be like, it's good. And I used to be like, you just saying that because I'm your brother. You know what I'm saying? She's like, nah, for real, it's good. But I would never let nobody know. And, you know, growing up, I grew up on hip-hop. Like, since I could understand what music was, that was the first music that was introduced to me.
Cool.
You know, I used to hear my moms play old shit, but for me, for somebody to be like, hey, this is what music is, it was like UTFO, Run DMC, LL Cool J. So
that's Pain in My Life. Talk a little bit about that and how you came up with putting together a record like that.
Pain in My Life is just like a record. I noticed hip-hop got in a fantasy state. Like, there's videos where dudes are throwing money around, kicking bags of money and all that. There's videos where dudes are driving Maybachs through the ghetto, like $300,000 cars and Ferraris. And I never seen that shit, you know what I mean?
Right.
If I seen a Ferrari, it was on TV or some shit like that. So it became in a whole fantasy state, like we were people with money to throw away. Well, meanwhile, reality of it, the inner city and the ghettos, people are poor. They live under the poverty level, like under poor. It's like poverty stricken. So it was almost like it became so fantasy driven. And I was like, what happened to songs like The Message, like Broken Glass, everywhere? Where you live? Yeah, like reality. And nobody was in touch. Like Tupac Shakur was the last artist we had that was in touch with the people. You know what I mean? Nobody is connecting with the people. Like we could see a song and like it, and that don't mean because I like your song, I'm going to go buy your record, or I want to know who you are or what you've been through because you made me want to dance. You know what I'm saying? And I feel like that's the difference between an artist, a real artist, and just somebody who has a record deal.
Speaking of what you've been through and the ghetto and everything being reality, you got an AKA. I'm sure you know it a lot better than I do. 96A0549.
That was my number. I was in jail for 7 years when I was a kid. I shot these two people. And you know, the government made me pay for it. You know, the white man did his part and he locked me up. But it was the best thing that ever could. Damn. God damn, that's
go-go. You see his introduction to Go-Go?
Yeah, them motherfuckers is rocking down there.
Hey, man, Saigon, welcome to D.C. for real.
Wow. Oh, shit, you need to come to D.C. I was like, it's an earthquake. Y'all don't feel like shit.
That's Mumbo Sauce in the background, man.
Mumbo Sauce, big shout out to Mumbo Sauce. If they doing it like that, I can't wait to finish this interview because I'm about to go see what that's about.
Yeah, we're going
to
get down there. We got to ask wrap these questions up so we can get you down there.
So the fact that the penitentiary system, how did that influence you and help you put things, you know what I mean?
The penitentiary saved my life, man, because I met good brothers. I met brothers in there who I used to idolize. I would hear their name around the community. And the dudes I was trying to be like growing up, I got a chance to meet these dudes. And they was like, nah, man, we took the wrong route. And I'm like, I was on the wrong route too, and they like, yeah, motherfucker, look where you at. You know what I'm saying? Right. We messed up.
So on some straight mess to the children that's watching.
To the
man.
Kids, I want y'all to know, like gangs and guns and all that. That's cool. Number one, gangs are for suckers. So if you join a gang, you're a sucker. That means you are not a man. You can't stand on your own. Feel what I mean? You feel like you need people to help you fight your battles and all that. But if you're a grown man, you're gonna have responsibility and you're gonna not come in, but you're gonna demand respect. You're gonna demand respect. Command is when you ask for it. Demand is when people just have to give it to you. Feel what I'm saying? Because of the way you carry yourself and things of that nature. So gangs and guns ain't nothing good to come out of it, so it's stupid.
Working with Mark Ronson, tell me a little bit about that and how did you get introduced to him and what's your relationship status now?
Me and Mark Ronson are on great terms, you know what I mean? He's my only Jewish friend in the world. Big shout out to the Jews. Mark Ronson is a good cat, man. Like, he, I met him when I first came out of jail. And somebody who heard me rap knew him and was like, yo, this was, he was a DJ. And I used to carry his records. He used to be like, because he promised me a record deal. Like, I'm going to put you on one day. All you got to do is carry these records. I was like, it beats me. And he give me a few dollars because I wasn't trying to go back to prison. You know what I mean? That's and cool. He used to give me studio time. And he told me one day I'm going to start a label. Mm. And, you know, he started his label one day. And he called me. He was like, yo, I'm starting my label. What you want to do? And I was like, yo, man, if you willing to work with me. We worked together, it didn't work out. Like, we have creative differences, but we remain friends. And like, he's Jewish, and I go to his house for Christmas dinner. What you know about that?
That's real. Big shout out to Mark Ronson.
Every Christmas, I'm at Mark Ronson's crib. After I leave my crib, of course, I hit Mark Ronson's crib. Congratulations to Wale, DC native.
DC.
Shout out to Wale, and shout out to, he got a big deal with Interscope.
Interscope, right.
Big look, my
is
dude.
Is it Alito Records?
Alito. All
right.
And big shout out to Mark on the, he won Grammy of the Year.
Yeah.
Producer of the Year. Exactly. He beat Timbaland for Amy Winehouse.
Yeah. That was like a good look.
That's my nigga right there.
That's,
you know,
amazing.
You proud of a nigga like, ah.
So you stopped working with Mark. And now you're doing with Just Blaze. I mean, you was the lucky dude, ain't you?
Yeah, lucky, right? All
right, tell me about Just Blaze. Obviously, that ties you right into the president himself, the man, Mr. Jay-Z.
Yeah,
and you did a track with him. How was that experience, man, to do something with Jay?
Me and Jay been friends for like 4 or 5 years now. So it wasn't that big of a deal because I've been around him a lot. But it was amazing that he would work with a new artist that wasn't a Rockefeller, you know what I mean? Because it ain't like we paid him for the verse. You know what I'm saying? How much that would have been my whole budget? 300. He would have been like, "Oh, give me 300,000 for that." But so he did it out of love. He did it out of love for Just Blaze, and you know the relationship we had. And I respect him, man. He's a real cat. You know what I mean? He always stay humble. He don't ever act like I'm Jay-Z. You know, I see him and we have 20-minute conversations. He'd be in the middle. He see me as love. You know what I mean?
You kind of diversifying the portfolio real quick, huh? We can catch you on HBO. Hanging out with Turtle and man. Talk about how you came about getting a cameo on Entourage.
There was actually, at the time, when they was auditioning for the part, it was between me, Young Jeezy, and another rapper, and I beat all them niggas for the part. Like, the Young Jeezy album hadn't come out yet, not even Thug Motivation. His first album wasn't even out yet. And I, of course, my album wasn't out, obviously. And they bought us, they sent us both. My man G Robinson was like, "You wanna audition for this TV show?" I was like, "Hey, let's get it popping." They flew me to LA, I auditioned for it. They called me back like three weeks later, like, "Can you do it?" I was like, "Hell yeah." And nobody knew the show was gonna be this big at the time. Cause when I taped my episodes, they had only been 8 episodes. The show wasn't a hit at the time. So the show became a hit in the second season, and that's when, not saying I made it a hit, but
he not saying that. He ain't officially saying that.
I made it a hit in the hood.
Man, for the people out there, man, the fan base that you acquired, what you want to tell them, man? What's coming? The greatest story never told. What's going on?
My album is coming. My album is definitely coming out. It's done. Just Blaze produced it. Kanye West, Red Spider. I ain't used a lot of producers. I got a lot of features. Faith Evans is on it. Jay-Z's on it. Q-Tip. Fat Man Scoop, Devin the Dude, Lazy Bone, Flowetry, everybody. I'm gonna tour this album for the rest of my life.
Yeah, okay.
I could do one and done. I could do one and done.
But that kills you. Already answered the next question, man. I appreciate you. Thanks for coming through, Saigon.
Thank God. I'm working on a second album. I'm writing it. It's called Thank God. Piece of Shari. Moral of the story. Go get that and go get the Honor Amongst Thieves. Man,
DPCDs, we don't need PCP. We don't need flat screen TVs and DVDs. We need more knowledge of who we be. See, really know where the guns come from? Do we really know where the drugs come from? How come it only affects us and not them? How come Jesus Christ is still not?